My hands are a city by the fembots. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Olympic Games last only 2 weeks, but their legacy will be felt in Vancouver for years to come. The price tag for taxpayers is estimated around $6 billion, including around $1 billion in security costs. Last week, International Olympic Committee President Jacques Rogge praised Vancouver organizers, calling the Vancouver model, quote, a blueprint for future games. Well, to talk more about that blueprint and what it could mean for Vancouver as well as future host cities, we go to Vancouver, where we're joined by Am Johal. He's the chair of the Impact on Communities Coalition, a watchdog group around the Vancouver Olympics, founded in 2001. Am Johal also initiated Canada's 2010 homelessness hunger strike, a rolling nationwide hunger strike calling for a national housing program in Canada. We welcome you to Democracy Now!, Am Johal. So the Olympics are underway. In the Olympics themselves, one major tragedy with the death of a luge player, a luge athlete, because of their saying the way the track was set, and they've changed that. But what else is happening in Vancouver now?
Amy, first of all, I just wanted to say to apologize on behalf of Canadians for the way that you were treated at the border here just a few months back. In terms of Vancouver, polling is showing that only about 50% of people are supportive of the Olympics, which is very different than many host cities. One would assume it would be at 80% or 90% if the Olympics are actually doing what they were intended to be doing in terms of economic development and all of these other premises that they're based on. But here in Vancouver, particularly around housing, civil liberties, the costs of the games. In all of these areas, these major impacts are being felt. And so this resistance that you're seeing in Vancouver, which is widespread and has the support of a wide swath of the public, is being felt. In the area of housing, we've had a net loss of 1,300 single resident occupancy hotel units, where a number of low-income people have lived in this city. This is a goes in line with what happened in Atlanta, in Salt Lake City, other Olympic Games. And so right at the very beginning, during the bid process, we knew what had happened in other places, and we raised these questions and concerns. Yet, during the bid process, the International Olympic Committee has not changed their bidding process, and it's essentially one of the largest corporate franchises in history, and we buy this with public money. And even though it's explained to us that this is going to result in economic development, it certainly benefits the tourism industry, it certainly benefits the development industry, it certainly benefits the construction trades. But after that, the economic benefits are really quite questionable, particularly around the issue of opportunity costs. From the day that the Olympics were awarded to Vancouver to the day that the opening ceremonies took place, homelessness more than doubled in this region. And so when we see the amount of money that was spent on the opening ceremonies, or $1 billion on security, and at the same time these social indicators that across this city and across this region, seeing this change happen, it's difficult for people not to make that connection. We also have a budget coming up in British Columbia in a few weeks' time, where we're going to see massive cuts to health care and education as well. On the area of civil liberties, incredible impacts. We've had social activists visited at their homes and workplaces. We've had a particular public policy, specific public policy, put forward by the City of Vancouver to meet the needs of the International Olympic Committee and to protect corporate sponsors, which clearly violates freedom of speech and the civil liberties of citizens. You can get fined right now in the City of Vancouver for using a megaphone phone near an Olympic live site or near an Olympic venue. So this kind of criminalization of protest and freedom of speech is part of the Olympic project. And this happens in virtually every Olympic Games. To date, we've already filed three human rights complaints to the UN against the government of Canada.
What do you mean people are visited at their homes?
Social activists who have been critical of the Olympic Games have been visited at their homes by the Integrated Security Unit, which is the unit responsible for security around the Games. Chris Shaw, a prominent anti-Olympics activist, was visited at a coffee shop near where he works at UBC. People that he knows, friends, acquaintances of his, were also visited and asked to do background on him. So I think this kind of thing that you would never suspect would exist in Canada is happening under this exception around the Games. I think added to that is the purchase of equipment and bureaucratic inertia around the Olympic Games. We have an expansion of closed-circuit television cameras happening. We had the purchase of military-grade sonic weapon that was first used against G20 demonstrators in Pittsburgh that was purchased by the Vancouver Police Department without any democratic consultation about whether we needed such a piece of equipment in the city of Vancouver. They did eventually take down the piece that could blow out eardrums and are simply using it as an audio device. But these are just the things that we know about. In terms of activists being visited, we know about that. The other levels of surveillance, whether people's emails are being checked or whether cell phones are being tapped, we also know, for example, that protests that happen in Victoria when the march was taking place, the bus driver of that, the bus driver was actually an undercover police officer. So there's an incredible amount of surveillance of those who have been critical of the Games. And many of the extent of which we won't know until after the Games when we go through the public process. And certainly around the cost of the Games, $6 billion is just what we know about. After all the costs come in for shipping in snow into areas that there weren't any, we're certainly going to see those budget numbers go up.
Am Johal, what about the First Nations response to the Olympic Games in Vancouver?
Absolutely. The four bands that are in the downtown area signed on as four host First Nations, but in terms of the rank and file membership of these organizations, there's been a significant amount of dissent. Here in Vancouver, we also have a significant urban Aboriginal community, which were largely left out of the bid process or any of the consultation process. Amongst the 2,800 or so homeless people in Vancouver, 32% are Aboriginal. And so many of the low-income people that are represented here in the city, literally blocks away from the opening ceremonies, have had no consultation or benefits resulting from these Games. And I think people like David Dennis and other people who have been raising these questions in the media are doing an incredible job of organizing and mobilizing people, whether we're talking about the civil liberties community or the Aboriginal community or the environmental community. The protest that happened on February the 12th was an incredible convergence of groups. It was a peaceful demonstration. And really what we have here is a kind of right to the city movement that's building, that's about asserting human rights in the urban domain. And I think that's particularly exciting because we're really asserting what we're for rather than simply being against the Olympic Games. There's much to be against the Olympic Games simply because this happens in virtually every city. In Vancouver, this bid process was going through back in 2002, and we were actually in contact with people from Salt Lake City about the impacts. We flew people from there to here to talk about what happened. So it's not as if we didn't know what was going to happen. It's just that the organizing process is done like a franchise model. It's a cookie-cutter approach, and it really leaves civil society organizations on the sidelines. Even those people who didn't oppose the Games, who were mildly critical, who were ready to be around the table. Once the bid was awarded to Vancouver, they were asked to sign communications protocols so they wouldn't criticize the Olympic project. And so those groups that were around the table that signed on to an inner-city inclusive commitment statement that had commitments around housing and civil liberties, literally years after the game, they didn't have a table to sit at. And some of these promises that were made, for example, like the athletes' village, where there were supposed to be 252 units of social housing, because that project has been mismanaged, those units may not ever happen. They may not become social housing units at all. So even the paltry promises that they made likely will not come true.